The Atheist Debates Patreon project presents a primer on contradictions in Scripture. Because of the Atheist Experience TV show and the Atheist Debates project and the debates and lectures that I do, I get lots of email and I see lots of comments on Facebook. And one thing that I've noticed is that people seem to be really focused on occasion with proposed contradictions in Scripture or problems with a holy book. And this is not a trivial matter, but sometimes the objections that they raise take on a rather mocking tone. When I read these emails, it sounds a little bit like, oh my gosh, these theists are so stupid. How could they not see that this obviously contradicts that? Look, for example, in Proverbs 26, verses 4 and 5, verse 4 says, answer not a fool according to his folly. And verse 5 says, answer a fool according to his folly. Those verses are right together. How did they miss this? Now, those suggesting that this particular passage in Proverbs is in fact a contradiction may ironically wind up looking foolish. And I say ironically because the bulk of Proverbs 26 talks about fools and foolishness. But before we can take a look at that passage in Proverbs to figure out what's really going on here, what are contradictions? Why are we even concerned about contradictions in Scripture? Isn't that something that we would expect? So let's take a look. So first of all, contradictions in Scripture only matter if we're talking about a scenario where there's a perfect being who is perfectly conveying a message that is intended to be understood by the reader. Is that the case? I mean, certainly we hear a lot of, you know, hyperbole and bluster and proud proclamations that God is perfect, it is a perfect being, and we can talk about, you know, the problems of a perfect being. Could they ever create an imperfect universe to begin with, or even a universe that could possibly become imperfect at the hands of somebody else? But not everyone who, for example, adheres to the Bible thinks that it is a perfect book or even that it's supposed to be a perfect book. Some people will claim that their holy book is perfect and free of error, which will prompt people to look for errors. And so if you're dealing with someone who says, ah, yes, the Bible is perfect, there are no contradictions, it makes sense to look for potential contradictions, because we can then construct an argument, a reductio ad absurdum, to show that, you know, God is a perfect being and the Bible is perfect and without error. Here's an error in the Bible, therefore now we've got a conflict, and your statement that the Bible is without error is demonstrably not true. But not everybody looks at the Bible in that way. Apologists, engaging in their apologetics exercise, which we'll talk about in the next video, are there to be defenders of the faith, to defenders of what they believe. And because of this, there have been a number of explanations of proposed contradictions. The lists that are on the internet that you find, you'll find great graphical resources and good sites like Skeptics Annotated Bible and infidels.org, and you can do a quick internet search for a list of contradictions in the Bible. You can also find lists that talk about problematic passages in the Bible that aren't necessarily contradictions. The thing to be aware of is that some of the contradictions they list are probably correct. Some of them definitely are not, and some of them aren't necessarily contradictions at all. This is a confusing mess, and that is something to keep in mind, that there's so much confusion around this. You have people saying the Bible is perfect, or the Quran is perfect, or this scripture is perfect, and then when somebody points out what appears to be, to perhaps most reasonable people, an error, a contradiction, the apologists say, oh, that's not a contradiction because. So when we say that something is a contradiction, what sorts of categories could we put contradictions in? So the first, most obvious type of contradiction is where a specific phrase in one portion of Scripture seems to contradict a specific phrase in another portion of Scripture. Do this, don't do this. And when we see something like that, it's our responsibility to investigate to see, is there some way of determining what the author meant or intended. The problem here is that the Bible isn't a single book by a single author. Even for those who would view that God inspired people to write, you still have different individuals. You have in the Christian Protestant Bible 66 books by a number of different authors. You would expect in those situations with different authors that mistakes are going to happen or there might be confusion. The problem is when we say there is a God who's perfect, who was inspiring this. If one portion of Scripture contradicts another portion of Scripture, what that does is it means that the Scripture that we have is not trustworthy. If in fact there are contradictions, Scripture, inspired or not, becomes untrustworthy. This is why people are focusing on contradictions. There's another category of contradiction where a specific passage in Scripture contradicts some accepted fact about reality. Perhaps when it lists the order of creation events, that conflicts with what we recognize to be true about reality. If it were to say, you know, the sky is burgundy and grass is blue and birds walk on eight legs, these sorts of things clearly contradict with facts about reality and would render the passages absurd. So when we're looking at what counts, we also have to consider which problems with the Bible, contradiction or otherwise, or which contradictions within any scripture are relevant. Because apologists have found ways to either reconcile apparent contradictions or to point out where those people who saw contradictions are in fact wrong in their understanding of what this passage means. But there are a number of other claims that apologists make that change the way we can look at these, and they're not all wrong. It's not just, oh, these are just excuses and they're post hoc rationalizations. Some of them may well be, but some of them are also reasonable ways of looking at a particular text. It's only the case where someone says, there is a perfect God who specifically instructed this perfect thing to be written, and we find that that perfect thing is in fact imperfect, that we have a strong contradiction like this. A number of the cited contradictions aren't going to be a problem for most people because of some reasonable objections that apologists have presented. So what are they? So there's a number of things that apologists say, including this first one, scribal errors, that in the process of copying down the original text, the scribes made an error. And so you'll hear something about, you know, whether somebody has 10 shekels or 40 shekels, that may in fact be a contradiction, but it's just a scribal error. Somebody wrote it down wrong. And that's potentially reasonable. They'll also claim that the person reading it simply has misunderstood. And for a number of reasons, because often there are peculiarities of the original language, various idioms or things that had an understanding at the time that are different from what we would expect on a modern reading. So a peculiarity of language at the time, of idioms, metaphors. Then there's also peculiarities that arise during translation, not just alterations in the language, but if somebody misunderstood this particular passage or had relied on a translation or an interpretation that was not quite correct, then the new modern English version, or whatever version you happen to be reading in, that isn't, you know, Greek, Aramaic, and Hebrew, is wrong. And maybe even the translations that you can get that are Greek, Aramaic, and Hebrew are in fact also wrong. Because one thing that apologists will often say is the Bible is perfect in its original form. The problem is we don't have its original form. Nobody living has seen the original form. We have translations of copies of copies of copies of translations of oral traditions. Now, which one of those is right? Was it the first written version that was right? Because we don't have any of those. Or was that already mistaken because these were transcriptions of oral traditions? Maybe the oral tradition was correct and perfect, but when they wrote it down the first time, they got it wrong, and those errors multiplied. Saying that the Bible, or any scripture, is flawless in its original form is a faith position if you don't have access to the original form. It is just a statement about what you believe. It is not, in any way, a testament to what is actually true. Is the Bible flawed in its original form? Which is the original form? I mean, technically, apologists could argue that the original form isn't the first one written, and it's not even the oral tradition. The original form is whatever was in God's mind that he inspired to be written, in which case it could be flawed for every version we've ever had access to. This faith-based position begins with the idea that God can't be wrong, or that there's not an evil God, or that God's not trying to confuse anybody. These assumptions bias their interpretation of Scripture, and it raises an interesting question. Why is there any question about what these things mean at all? Why is there any confusion? Why can't God communicate well with the beings he supposedly created and has an important message for? This, to me, seems to be the single most significant thing. The message, if you're a God and you have an important message to convey, shouldn't be confusing to anybody, should, at least not upon a reasonable, well-intentioned, honest reading of the passage. And furthermore, somebody who has mental issues that don't allow them to read and understand things as they were intended, that also sounds like a problem, because an all-powerful, all-wise, all-benevolent, knowing God who wants to communicate with that individual has already picked a flawed way to begin, because they've created an individual who simply cannot ever understand what it is this God wants to convey. Language evolves over time. The meaning of terms and phrases change. We have a hard time understanding something like Shakespeare, which is in our recent history, let alone things in languages that have died out. We can't really have a full understanding of the times and the thoughts and the heads of the individuals at the time this is written. All we can do is our best guess. And I'm not faulting apologists for that. They are doing what they think is their best estimation of what these passages are intending to mean. The problem is that they have no way of demonstrating that they're actually correct. And saying that these things are flawless in their original form, when you have no access to the original form and no way to demonstrate that they could be flawless in their original form, is also a problem. So with that in mind, let's take a look at that passage from Proverbs that I received an email recently and I've heard many times before. Is this really a contradiction? So in Proverbs chapter 26, verse 4 begins with, "Answer not a fool according to his folly." And verse 5 says, "Answer a fool according to his folly." And I know a number of people have read that and are like, "Oh my gosh, this is such an obvious contradiction. Ah ha ha." Hang on a second. Do you really think that the person writing this would write down one verse that says one thing and one verse that says another, back to back? I mean, does that seem reasonable at all? Maybe there's a little bit more going on here. Maybe what we're talking about is a particular structure, and there's additional context to look at. And the context exists in the verses. Verse 4, in its entirety, is, "Answer not a fool according to his folly, lest you be like him yourself." And verse 5 is, "Answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own eyes." So when you take this entire thing in context, what these two verses are saying aren't actually contradictory. It's not saying, don't answer a fool unto his folly, and do answer a fool unto his folly. What it's saying is, exercise caution. When you're talking with somebody who's foolish, don't let them drag you down to their level so that you are made to look foolish, but directly challenge what they're saying so that they are not convinced that their foolishness is wisdom. I mean, this is, and I realize this isn't the most popular proposed contradiction that people have offered, but I got it in email. I've seen it before. It's on a number of websites. There's no contradiction here when you look at the entire package. It's a literary tool that is not completely uncommon in scripture like this, where somebody is saying, do this, but do it in this way. Make sure, consider what your reasons are for doing it. You know, if somebody's yelling at you Don't yell at them in such a way that you end up looking as angry as they do. But you can certainly yell at them in exposing that they are not justified. This comes up sometimes when people will say, why are you atheists so angry? And there is this idea of righteous indignation. Why are people who have been oppressed angry at people who are their oppressors or people who they even associate with those oppressors? They have a justification. And so you could say to people, don't be angry with these people, lest your anger appear to be, you know, diminishing to your value, to your estimation in their eyes. But you have a right to be angry with these situations and with these people to expose the problems. This is exactly the same as what we're talking about in Proverbs 26, verses 4 and 5. Also, the entire book, or at least the chapter 26 in Proverbs, is all about exposing foolishness. And even just a simple read-through should let you know that these things aren't meant to be literal instructions that you could excise a portion of it on its own. If you get down to verse 27, it says, he who digs a well or a hole will fall into it. Well, we know that's not true. People have dug plenty of holes that they haven't fallen into. This is a cautionary tale to say, think about what you're doing, think about your motivations, exercise some caution, because the fool who digs a hole is likely to fall into it. It's all about not being foolish. It is not about not correcting people. And so this particular contradiction kind of goes away. There's another common objection that people have raised about Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2 being contradictory, because they are two apparently conflicting stories about the creation. Now, I'll get into this another time when we start actually going through specific contradictions that people raise, which ones are valuable, which ones aren't, which ones are incorrect. But far more significant, I think, is if you take a look at the order of the events of creation in the Genesis 1 account and compare it to what we understand to be the facts about reality, where, you know, you're not going to have plants before you have light, and et cetera. That contradiction, the contradiction with the facts of reality, is far more significant. Now, apologists will find a way to try to make sense of this, of these proposed contradictions. And it's a mistake to assume that their bias, which almost certainly exists, means that their explanation is wrong. That actually betrays a different type of bias on the part of the person who's finding objections, and that is, you seem to have this idea that your reading and understanding of it is necessarily correct from the beginning, and that there's a problem here, and that no reasonable explanation for that apparent problem could exist. You'll find lots of places on the internet where you can find lists of contradictions, and if you're the type of person who looks at that and just goes, hey, these guys know way more about the Bible than I do, and if they say that this verse contradicts this verse, then I'm going to grab that and add it to my arsenal, and the next time I'm arguing with my grandmother about, you know, whether or not Christianity is believable, I'm going to pull this out as a contradiction, and she's going to have no reply to it. Well, she might. In that scenario, you may well be the one who's in a faith-based position where you are trusting someone else's understanding. One of the important things is to investigate these things and have a good enough understanding. So if we're going to focus on contradictions, what should be in our mind? I think one of the first questions you should ask yourself is, why am I doing this? For what reason am I trying to point out a contradiction or a problem with Scripture? Does the person I'm talking to, do they even think that their holy book is free of contradictions? If you're talking to someone who has already reconciled this and understands, hey, there's scribal errors, there's things that don't make sense, there are definitely contradictions in my Scripture, but they're not problematic because they're not contradictions where matters of doctrine or salvation or whatever are concerned. If that's the type of person you're talking to, then you are completely wasting your time pointing out many of these contradictions. You could, of course, point out problems with the doctrine, including doctrinal notes that contradict with each other. And the goal should be to raise these so that they can attempt to offer an explanation or an understanding for it. Because one of two things, or one of three things, will happen. Either they'll give you an explanation that is sensible. Maybe you misunderstood something. Maybe they have a better understanding of it. Or they will give you an explanation that is further problematic, that may include additional contradictions and problems, and then you get to keep going down this pathway. Or they may have no explanation at all. And in that case, you can say, okay, I understand that and I appreciate that, and I don't know is a good answer. But you are saying that you believe these things, and you are potentially putting your immortal soul that you believe you have at risk by believing in things that you acknowledge you don't understand. So what is your goal in pointing out the contradictions? Are you arguing against a straw version of what your interlocutor understands or believes? Or are you actually arguing for, you know, something that's orthodox? Have they departed from orthodoxy? Do they have good reason to depart from this? Have you bothered to research this? Did you just go out and grab what somebody else said about contradictions? Or did you look through it? Did you read through it? Did you try to understand it? Did you take a look at what both non-theists or non-adherents to this scripture and adherents to the scripture have had to say? We have a rich history of people who have proposed contradictions and apologists who have provided explanations and answers for them. And if you haven't bothered to even look into how these things might be explained, what are you going to do when they come back with an explanation? How are you going to have a good enough understanding to say, oh, no, I've heard this particular explanation before. Here's what's wrong with it. Here's why I couldn't possibly accept this. This is a, you know, post hoc rationalization. You're just making stuff up after the fact. If you haven't bothered to look into it, as soon as you start talking to somebody who may understand this better than you do, you could potentially be in trouble. Can you find fault with the popular apologetics? And are you willing, if somebody presents you with a new apologetic, to say, that's something I hadn't considered before, let me think about it and get back to you? Are you being biased in your perceptions? Do you have such a strong belief that there is no God, or that this Bible is crap, or that this scripture cannot possibly be perfect, that you're not willing to engage in reasoned discussion, but instead you have a prejudice that is encouraging you to find fault where there may not be any? Now, at a future time, we're going to start going through some of the proposed contradictions, and I think that we're going to find some that are incredibly troubling, both internal conflicts and conflicts with what we know about the outside world. But I always want to be fair in making sure that we're not just relying on what I have to say or my own research, that we're looking at what apologists have said and trying to demonstrate where there are problems with their explanation and being honest enough to accept where there is not a problem. In, for example, this passage in Proverbs, it's not a contradiction. It is, I mean, this is a literary technique. And sticking with Proverbs, if you go back to Proverbs 3:5, it says, lean not on your own understanding. And I find that to be great advice. I don't particularly like the rest of the advice in Proverbs 3:5, where it says to trust in God, because I have no way to lean on a God that I don't think exists, or I don't have any reason to think that this God, if he did exist, is necessarily right. I don't have any pathways of communication, and it doesn't matter whether or not there is a God who says a certain thing, because that thing is either true or not true, independent of who says it. It doesn't matter if I say it or if a God says it or anything else. It is either true or not true. You don't just get to assume that God is only going to say true things. But this is all kind of a distraction anyway, because we have no reason to think that anybody is in fact communicating from God. So when it says, you know, trust in God and lean not on your own understanding, I would argue that that passage really, in the Protestant realm, where you are supposed to have a personal relationship with God and you can't demonstrate this, that you may in fact be saying, lean not on your own understanding, but go ahead and use your own understanding to try to understand God and then lean on that. It's a really kind of muddled mess there. But I can live my life leaning not only on my own understanding, but by engaging with the people who've spent countless hours of their lives studying this in greater detail than I have. And by the way, if you don't have any interest in this sort of thing, you don't have to offer an explanation to anybody. You don't have to go seeking contradictions. You don't have to engage in debates. But that's the kind of thing that we're trying to focus on here at the Atheist Debates Project. Use caution when grabbing lists of contradictions. Have some good understanding of it. Make sure you're not engaged, you're not the one engaging in a faith-based position, that your argument doesn't ultimately rest on something specious. Contradictions are potentially a big deal, but are they the end-all be-all of what we should be focusing on? I mean, are you really going to convince somebody that because bats aren't birds, that they should give up their belief in a risen savior? Not only is that a good question, but is it even a contradiction that you found? Maybe. If it is a contradiction, is it one that is that matters? Is it significant? Does it expose some flaw in the doctrine? Does it show that the claims of a particular religious scripture are in conflict with, you know, seemingly incontrovertible facts about reality? That in order for us to change our understanding of reality, not only would we need this scripture and confidence that it's correct, but we'd need additional information to change the paradigm that we use to assess the world. When I think about contradictions in scripture, there are a number of points that I find are far more important than here's a verse and here's a verse and they seem to be in conflict. The first is, why is there any confusion at all? In 1 Corinthians, the Bible says that God is not the author of confusion, and yet there is a lot of confusion. There are well over 1,000 different denominations that all identify as Christian, and I know we're primarily focusing on the Bible. Not every objection in here applies to all religions, but speaking within Christianity, there are countless denominations who disagree on every single point. This is something I raised in a debate with Matt Slick, where he debated another Christian on a matter of doctrine. Now, was it an obvious contradiction? I would say so. Is it necessarily a defeater for their position? Well, not necessarily, but we do know that at least one of them, if not both of them, were in fact wrong. So if there's a God and he is wise and he has an important message and he wants everybody to understand it, why is there any confusion? And some apologists will reply with, what makes you think God wants everybody to understand it? Maybe this message is only intended for a chosen few. Well, if that is in fact the case, and it is in fact the case that God inspired Scripture, then God is the author of confusion. What you're arguing in that case is that he is intentionally deceiving some people, or he's intentionally making it so that some people don't properly understand the message. And that is, I would argue, by definition, confusion. That this isn't a clear and obvious message. You can't have it both ways. You can't say all you have to do is read the Scripture and God will reveal it all to you. This gets back to what we've talked about before, where this claim that God will reveal himself to anybody who wants to, and then when you find some, or, you know, comes to him with an honest heart and blah, 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 and then when you point out, I've actually done this, oh, well, that's your fault. You know, I can't be wrong about God. And so the same thing ends up being true about the scriptures. I can't be wrong about scriptures. There's tons of confusions. There's multiple different versions of the Bible. Where's the correct one? You can't say that it is perfect in its original form when you have no access to its originals. You can't even tell me which version of the Bible is correct. There are people who are 1611 King James Version as the authorized version. That is the only version of Scripture. And it's the one that God authorized. And not only is this a very, you know, English centric view that God has revealed one true English version, which in some people's minds supplants any other version, any attempt for anyone to understand, you know, the Septuagint or any of these other texts in a way that doesn't conform almost letter for letter to the 1611 King James Version, they're mistaken. And so this is also a faith-based position, not only that it's perfect in its original form, but that God has authorized this particular English version. Why would anybody communicate by text a very important message for such a long span of time, when we know that text can be altered, that it can be misunderstood, that languages change and languages die out? You can't put the responsibility for all the confusion upon the wicked hearts of men when it is plainly obvious that even in a scenario where there was a God who was conveying a message, he chose an awful way to attempt to communicate clearly with countless people over millennia. what kind of communicator is this God? Why can't he interact in a way that is clear? If he's truly not the author of confusion, I think you can make a compelling case that he's definitely not the author of the Bible, and he may not be the author of anything. Statements which conflict with observations about reality should be the highest level contradiction to address. If you find that there's a statement in Scripture which conflicts with something that even believers accept about reality, the earth is flat versus round. I'm not saying that the Bible necessarily says the earth is flat. There are clear interpretations that would go along with that, but there are also interpretations that may not say that. But if you were to find a passage that says the earth is a square, flat, 100-mile thick plate floating in space, and the people you're talking to want to try to simultaneously believe what this says and the facts about reality, that the earth is an oblate spheroid orbiting, the sun, those two things are in conflict. Those are some of the strongest potential contradictions you can present. The ones that contradict facts about reality, which are accepted by the person you're talking to. It doesn't help if those facts about reality aren't accepted. Internal inconsistencies that specifically apply to doctrine, I think, are probably the second tier, where when you're asking questions about how does one become saved, or is there anything to be saved from or to, but what do I have to do to be saved? And you have one portion of Scripture saying, then keep the commandments, sell all your belongings, give the money to the poor. And the other one is call out to the Lord Jesus Christ and surrender and, repent and blah, blah, blah. And another one says, that salvation by faith without works is useless, so you have to have works too. As you're trying to go through like these problems of soteriology, of what it takes to be saved, those are doctrinal contradictions or potential contradictions. They at least require some reasonable explanation that then becomes agreed upon, that this is understood to be the way. It doesn't necessarily become the case just by saying, hey, we all believe this version, because that's how you get to 1,000 different denominations of Christianity. So internal inconsistencies should be second. I think that for the most part, it is pointless to spend time talking about things that are likely scribal errors. There's a lot of things where numbers are presented that are absolutely ridiculous. The number of potential slaves in Egypt, vastly outnumbering, any area in that time from what we know. The numbers surrounding, the wealth and riches or strength of a particular kingdom. These could be exaggerations. They could be outright lies. They could be scribal errors, but they don't go to doctrine. And so if somebody says, this is, 20 cubits and four, somebody else says, no, it's 40 cubits. This is not necessarily a defeater for the foundations of the religion. It is a problem with the Bible, and it's easily dismissed by people who don't think that the particular version, language version of the Bible you're looking at is in fact error-free. There's a fairly small percentage of people who would say that the Bible that they hold in their hands and read is in fact error-free. Those people are easily debunked. They may never accept it. They are already holding such an irrational position that it may be futile to have a conversation about potential conflicts in their scripture. Instead, you might have to begin with a conversation about how we would go about discerning truth and what is then reasonable. So scribal errors become largely irrelevant unless there's someone who's clearly arguing for perception, for perfection in what they're actually holding. But for those who want to say that the Bible is perfect in its original form, ask them to produce the originals. They can't do it. They have no access to it. And merely by them saying, as a response to raised objections about the Bible, well, it's perfect in its original form, they are implicitly saying, you're correct, the form we have isn't perfect. And then they're making a second statement that they cannot possibly back up, which means your objection stands as a victory over that point. It may not be sufficient to convince somebody that everything that they believe about their religion is false, and it shouldn't be, because that would also be a fallacy. But it's a clear demonstration that what they may believe about their religion isn't demonstrably true, and the excuse that they give for why they believe it isn't something that they have any access to.
This video is made possible by supporters of the Atheist Debates Patreon project. You can find more information and add your support at patreon.com/atheistdebates.